this guy is.
See, now they think that it's me you're talking about. You can't.
No, I'm talking about Tom Merritt.
Oh, yeah, dude.
The amateur. The rank amateur.
The guy who claimed he would be there for us and then wasn't. Mm. Everybody harass Ace Detect and tell him that he's late. He's late.
The person whom you're trying to reach is currently on a...
At least he has the voicemail feature turned on. Unlike me, who just lets it ring forever.
Bring, bring. Do-do-do-do-do.
All right, here. I'm gonna run and grab a tasty beverage. I'll be right back. And it's you and the...
Hello, everybody. Welcome to a new podcast. It's called Thesaurus Time with Andrew. So, random thesaurus words. Download. What's another word for download? We can have boot up, compute, computerize, crunch numbers, digitize, initialize, input, keyboard, key in, load, log in, log out, program, and run. There you go. That's just one fantastic installment from my Roger's 21st Century Thesaurus. I wonder what other fun words we can find here to look up some alternative. You know, because like, you know, as a writer, you're always trying to figure out different ways to say the same thing. Neshcom, as far as incorrect, it all depends on the context in which you want to use that word. So let's take another, let's look up another word here. What else do we want to look up here? Cry. What are all the different alternatives if I wanted to say Bryce was crying or Bryce cried? Yell, bark, bawl, bay, bellow, bleat. He bleat. He was so upset that he bleated. Cackle, call, caw, chatter, cheer, clack, clamor, cluck, coo, croak, crow, ejaculate. If he cried out loud.
What did I just miss?
Moving right along. Exclaim. I'm looking through my thesaurus and finding all the different alternatives to the word cry.
Oh, I like ejaculate. So, yeah, because that's what I. That's the two are equivalent in my life. I weep with ecstasy and loneliness every time I ejaculate.
Vociferate.
Let me try calling Tom directly. Call Tom Merritt.
Calling Tom Merritt. Do you ever have like Siri activate in the middle of an audiobook if she's plugged in?
Oh, no, I haven't. I usually am listening on earphones, though, so it makes sense that she wouldn't hear it.
I've had that happen. And I'll get, you know, my Amazon Echo, Alexa, in the middle of speech, will speak up.
Hey, buddy, are you online?
I'm not sure what you meant by that question.
Oh, got it. Okay. Okay, yeah, we can wait. Just call in on line two. Awesome. All right, see ya. Bye.
It's like I've got a plate of pancakes in front of me because it's Sunday.
Well, that's what I was afraid of, right? It's like normally he has it together. When he says he'll be there. But, you know, I've done that and then utterly spaced on a commitment because true unprofessional.
Yeah, I was in the middle of writing last week and I totally blew off like a conference call. I felt horrible. Satan, devil, angel of darkness, antichrist, Apollyon. Not familiar with that term.
Apollyon was one of the titles of the those.
Going to be some nerd
revelations.
Game thing or something. What's that?
Apollyon, I remember being the title of one of those Left Behind books near the end.
Yeah.
So,
Archfiend, Beelzebub, demon, Diabolus. King of Hell, Lucifer, Mephistopheles, Brian Brushwood, Prince of Darkness, the Evil Spirit.
Yeah.
Why? Did you think I said something that I didn't say?
No, I guess I heard what I wanted to hear. I apologize.
Mm-hmm.
So, if we can, you know, this would be kind of a funky thing to do. For after things, I don't know that I'm half packed and I have to leave. No, I should be able to hang around for a short after things.
Whatever you need to do. I'm not the one who's, you know.
Who's unprofessional? Here, I'll go ahead and tweet out that we are live for an early edition of the Weird Things podcast.
Yeah. Mr. Happy Pants for the Devil. True.
El Diablo de Mano.
So I went to Disneyland last night.
And?
So it's cool. It's like they, you know, every year they redo the haunted house for like the night before Christmas.
Yep.
It's cool. And then this year, I haven't seen this before. The Space Mountain
was cool. Oh, was themed around Star Wars, right?
No, that'd be awesome. No, it was Ghost Galaxy.
Oh, okay. All right.
Ghost Galaxy.
So what do they do?
Projection mapping on the Space Mountain exterior.
Hmm. Oh, that's cool.
It's kind of cool. Yeah.
Dude, all that projection mapping, that's a brilliant. I mean, you know that once they saw that tech, they're all like, we can give everything a makeover and it costs virtually nothing. I mean, the tech is not nothing, but I mean, it's like no infrastructure, no hiring construction, no shutting down rides, just at night, you know, align all these things, pay some programmers, and you suddenly have a brand new facility.
There was a Kickstarter program for an open source projection mapping system, because like you can use it now for, you know, video projectors have gotten so efficient that you can use them for theatrical lighting.
Yeah.
So, you know, if you want to light up a stage, you know.
Just throw it. Yeah. As a matter of fact, CJ, for his events, like you could get 800 by 600 VGA projectors for like $150 or something. And you can set the default image on them, like the no source image. So he just bought a bunch of those, set the default thing to his Game Shows to Go logo, and then just never plugs them into anything. Uses them just to turn them on and point the logos, because then you don't you get all the powerful projection. You don't have to get a custom gel or anything on there. That's amazing.
Yeah, I think I love, like, remember that video that somebody did where they had a back wall, side wall, and a floor, and they projected, you know, then moving landscape onto that.
Mm.
You know, a person could like wake up in their room, walk around, and do that. And so that's I think that's going to be kind of a growing thing.
Yeah, for a special early edition of Weird Things featuring Ace Detect and Andrew Main. Boo, boo, boo. Ace Detect.
Andrew Main. Star Wars merch was incredible there.
You know, I've noticed that there's some really savvy merch that's very kind of postmodern, you know, self-referential kind of stuff. Like the, I think it's the, I assume it's licensed, the one where you see Darth Vader riding the teacups ride or something.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, because it's, yeah.
Yeah. Hello, Tom Meritz.
Hello.
How are you, sir?
I am wielding a dead light bulb. Beware.
Oh, is that what's going on?
Sorry about that.
No, don't worry. I assumed everything was cool, but there's that outside chance that it's like, what if he forgot? So,
you never confirmed the noon.
Oh, I just asked if you could, and then you said yes.
And then I turned on my thing, and it didn't work.
Yeah. Hey, man, I'm looking forward to seeing you in approximately 8 hours.
Yeah, right? What time do you get in?
I want to say 9:50. So, I should be there. Last episode of this season's Rick and Morty is tonight?
Yeah.
Okay. So you want to save that to watch together, or?
As a family?
Yeah.
That's the way
I jumped the gun, by the way. I watched The Shield. Did you?
Which one?
Episode 5, I think.
Yeah. I've been watching that this morning, actually.
Okay.
I'm like 30 minutes away.
By the time it ended,
Not on Hulu anymore, by the way.
What's that?
Disappeared from Hulu.
What? No, so now you had to buy it.
Yeah. So and buying the whole season 7 was cheaper than buying the remainder of the episodes I had to watch. So now I own all of seasons.
That's what I did as well. And I'll tell you what, man, I really dig the Amazon player experience without the commercials or anything.
Hey there, Andrew Main.
Hello there, Mr. Merritt.
How are you?
Good.
Hey, keep it going, guys. I'm setting levels.
Okay.
You're real good.
Dub thee, Sir Andrew, knight of my replaced light bulbs.
What is that in your hand, sir?
This is a Kino Flow bulb.
Thought of some cool new double-bladed lightsaber.
Yeah, it is. It's my new. Me and JJ been working this up for episode 8.
So I was at Disneyland last night, and I saw possibly the coolest thing. I just didn't buy it though. I wanted though. You know, you're like, they go through the Star Wars universe looking for things they can make. Like, okay, we got guns, a lot of guns. We got a lot of spaceship. We got all these costumes. Finally, and I haven't seen this on Amazon or anywhere. I only saw it in the park. Imperial restraints, the handcuffs the stormtroopers use.
Oh, that's great.
Like on Chewbacca.
Yep. And so they have these imperial restraints.
Fuzzy arm links to make them more comfortable when you use them in bed?
They have foam on the inside. But I was like, man, that is hilarious because that's...
Imperial velvet strips.
Well, and you know that, I mean, it's great that they've mined it all the way down to that level, but meanwhile, you know that they're talking about, like, we need new crap to sell, people! Come on!
Yeah. I don't think they have a problem.
No, I do not either. Okay, we should be live on Alpha Geek Radio now, and...
Realize that was a little bright.
Yeah. All right, dude, I'm ready to start when you are. You ready to go?
I'm ready.
Okay, here, I'm going to delete all this, and then I'm going to say we're going to go in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Weird Things Podcast. I'm Andrew Main, joined by Brian Brushwood.
Back from the dead. I understand I was dead last week. Is that what happened?
I think we all were, right?
No, that's I was told in no uncertain terms that that I died, and that's why I was not on the podcast last week.
We didn't have a podcast last week.
Really?
What about the week before that?
Yeah.
The week before that. Yeah, I remember like some friend of ours did something last week.
No, I don't remember that person because the podcast has always been you and me and the fantastic Tom Merritt, host of
Daily
Technician.
Yeah, I didn't say there was somebody else who was a part of this podcast. I said that we had to go
that
to
would be
somebody
history, who wouldn't was it?
Doing something.
Got it. That makes sense now. I got it.
Weird Berenstain Bear moment. Okay, moving right along. So that's Tom Merritt, you know, as usual, as his course, as is everything normal here. It's the only normal thing here on Weird Things is this lineup.
We've always been at war with East Asia, and Tom Merritt has always been the co-host of the Weird Things podcast.
Yeah.
Speaking of war.
I can't imagine doing it all this years without you.
Yeah. Speaking of war.
Yes.
On the Late Show, the Colbert Late Show, still wrapping my head around that, Elon Musk declared war.
On Mars, right?
So, all right, guys, let me hear your opinion on this. Good idea or most awesome idea we've ever heard? Elon Musk, in order to terraform Mars, suggested, you know, hey, maybe what we need to do is just not drop some thermonuclear bombs on the ice caps. Speed things along.
There was, so, and by the way, from what I understand, that was like near the end of the interview. All of a sudden, he turns into the mad super genius that we all know he secretly is. He's literally building a spaceship fleet so he can take on Mars.
I love how he offhandedly said it, too. He's like, well, we could use nuclear bombs. I mean, that's in his arsenal. That's Elon Musk. He's like, well, I got all kinds of things. I could throw a comet at it. Or I could nuke it. Maybe we should nuke it.
I'm going to see if Neshcom can dig it up and throw it up on the diamondclub.tv second screen. But there was, in a Reddit thread, somebody mentioned, this is a known proposal that's been around for like 20 years. It is suggested that with as few as 4 thermonuclear bombs, you can create a not breathable, but a big enough atmosphere that it will create terraforming.
Big enough
basically.
Ass atmosphere works.
Big atmosphere.
So basically, if I remember the paper correctly, 4 nukes, 2 over each pole, is enough to vaporize all of that and sublimate all of that locked up CO2 on the poles. Because when you look at Mars and you see the frozen ice caps, that's all. Some of it is water, but most of it is carbon dioxide. And so if you unleash all that, you get a thick atmosphere that causes a miniature greenhouse effect that theoretically could warm everything up enough to where you have liquid water. They say, I would love to take a look at the paper because it. I want to say that like a third of the planet could be covered in water after just a couple of nukes and you just let it go runaway greenhouse.
Yeah, and that's the key effect there is that it's, you know, sometimes when you think about how long would it take to terraform Mars, you think about, well, how hard would it be to raise the temperature of it? And you think like, oh, you know, that becomes a big energy problem. But as you pointed out, in theory, you know, a few nukes might be enough to just start, you know, increase the moisture in the air. And the number one heat trapping gas there is that we have is water vapor in our own atmosphere. So more water vapor up there that starts trapping that. And CO2 obviously is, you know, the CO2 up there is fantastic for doing that and can be useful there. So that's a cool, I'm all for it. Yeah, you know, the
abstract, thank you very much, Neshcom, for pulling this up. The abstract of the paper says, 4 100-kilogram fusion warheads launched from a Mars orbiter can throw into the air enough dust to cover Mars' south polar cap. So it's not just that the nuke vaporizes it, it's that it creates enough dust that it darkens all of that, because normally it reflects all of that heat, and so cause it to sublime through increased solar heating. The added atmospheric pressure would set off a runaway advection effect and partially terraform the planet. We have the warheads and the orbiters. We could start whenever we like. So,
what a great disarmament move. Like, all right, we'll get rid of 2 nukes. Soviet Union, former Soviet Union, you get rid of 2 nukes. We'll terraform Mars together. What do you think?
Dude, I'm all for it. I mean, here's the thing. The only possible hiccup on all this is if there is currently living life on Mars. And I actually have flipped on this. I deeply, deeply hope there is no life on Mars. I hope.
So you can nuke it.
Well, no. I mean, because to be honest, if there's any life there, that means pretty much we're not going to ever go. We're not going to live there. We're not going to move there because it's too dangerous, too toxic. It could kill us, and we will destroy an indigenous species. And
speak for yourself.
Oh, really? Yeah, you wouldn't be worried about Mars, Martian bugs?
I mean, I'm worried about it, but I'm not going to be like, well, I'm not going to go because of that. I think that, you know, it comes down to, I think that's not the deal breaker. You know, I think we kind of have to expect that. There's the concern that, you know, when they asked other scientists, what did they think of this plan? And, you know, none of these scientists they asked, by the way, had their own space program. I'm just going to point that out. reactions were like, you know, maybe to like, well, no, it would take a lot more. Why not steer an asteroid or whatever? Like, well, it's got to be more targeted. It's not quite the thing that. Yeah, I think that a lot of people were just their exposure to the idea was probably the limit length of the phone call. But, you know, one concern and a justifiable concern, though, is the idea if there is life on Mars and we start terraforming before we get a chance to document and see what's there, we may never, you know, have an accurate picture of what Mars is like presently.
You don't think that politically, the moment we find out that there's life on Mars, that politically it becomes, you know, just this hot potato that nobody wants to say, yeah, let's go ahead and push it out of the way and start making our own turf?
That doesn't stop us from doing things now.
Well, but also, you know, we have a stronger conservation movement than we did, 400 years ago as we were moving over.
I'm saying presently, you know, there are things where people are like, don't go there, don't do this, you know, this ecosystem, we shouldn't violate it or whatever. And then some people say, well, yes, we weigh the benefits.
I don't know. I mean, I don't know what would happen. I don't think it's possible to know what politically would happen because it's such a complicated issue and we've never grappled with it before. But personally, if we found out there was life on Mars, I don't think we shouldn't go there. But I think we should make sure that we, you know, we study it enough to know what it was, where it came from, learn as much about it as possible. And then, I mean, I'm assuming we're talking about non-sentient life, right? We're talking about local fauna and flora, in which case I don't think it's wrong to move in and you know, try to, you know, make our own space there.
Yeah, I just think it's
Brian, you're saying you think it won't happen because people will object. Do you think it's wrong?
No. I don't think it's wrong. I say screw it. I say we're the dominant species and we win. And this, just, as far as I'm concerned, you know, this is just some real estate that we already own. That you know, we got squatters over
there.
Do
we own Mars?
Yeah. No, we sure do. As we drink from our Occupy Mars mugs. There is substantial.
Why would we need to occupy it if we already own it?
Well,
that's all I'm saying.
There is substantial scientific value to studying essentially an independently evolved organism, and I acknowledge that. But I'm with you guys. I would like very much to say, cool story, bro. You get that half the planet, And yeah, you know what? Actually, you get these reservations that we've carved out for you. The rest of it, we're just going to warm up and
well, and
do
it's
what
a whole
want.
Different situation if it's sentient life versus just, you know, so far the indication is if there is any life, it's like algae and bacteria,
lichen,
and,
you know.
Sure, sure, but and who knows? Like there could be tremendous advances, and that's what I worry about is people saying no, don't go terraform Mars. It's like the rainforest. It's more valuable than the rainforest because even though it's barren and wastes and it's only got these microbes, these are microbes that have evolved for millions and millions and millions of years in a completely independent format.
And that's why I'm saying you study and learn as much about them as possible so that if there is benefit to them, you can preserve them. Maybe you can put a part of original Mars under a dome,
you know,
et cetera. But
And this is the reason I bring up politically, because oftentimes political decisions, and this is the great part, is we're entering the age where politics will matter less and less, because when you're a madman with your own fleet of spaceships, the opinions of the local governments, and all of a sudden the United States becomes a local government, becomes increasingly less important to you as you
just
decide to go.
Well, no, politics is just the interrelationship of powerful organizations. You just become one of those powerful organizations. It doesn't make politics go away.
Yeah, and I think that, you know, we may say, you know what, let's not do it. I don't think the Russian or the Chinese are going to have the same viewpoint that we do.
Yeah. Yeah. I agree. While we're on the topic of
the Indians or the Japanese.
Did you guys see the walkthrough? TJ, our friend over at SpaceX, he sent us a link to the new inside views of the Dragon capsule. Did you see that? The crew module?
Oh my gosh, so cool.
Yeah, looks amazing. We'll see if
nice gray tones.
Yeah. Well, what's funny is we're seeing these little vignettes. Here we go. And Neshcom just put one on the second screen here. But we're seeing these little vignettes of the crew Dragon in orbit, you know, what it's like.
This is Dragon. Falcon is placed to
and it's amazing
like
because
the
obviously
Space Mountain intro.
Yeah.
We see the same. Time to next Delta V is
so they show
hour.
You a bit of you know, what it looks like from inside the crew module from the point of view of one of the astronauts. Spacious. You got portals all around. You got a futuristic space console that is an
you
actual
have to have
space
special
console.
Gloves to work with those touchscreens though, I bet.
It's missing me, like, eating Skittles floating in the air.
And by the way, it seems to be, I think it's interesting, when he looks out the window, you assume you're looking at Earth, but I think it's interesting that they...
Got a
they
reddish tint.
It's a reddish tint, and they're over a very red desert, like, you know, who knows what that could be over there.
Oh, but there's a reflection of an earthy thing.
I'm sure.
Yeah.
But I also suspect it was no accident that it was a very red desert they were looking down upon.
Elon Musk says the crew capsule of the Dragon is designed to land on any hard body in the solar system.
Dude, that's
including
amazing.
Brian's abs.
Mm. and that means that the hardest part is that you have to have your heat shielding because, you know, what burns you up in the atmosphere isn't the fact that there's atmosphere. It's the speed at which you go into the atmosphere. And if you're going to something really coming back from, let's say, Mars or going to Mars, you're going to be going there very, very ridiculously fast. And so... You know, you have to slow down, and you transfer all that momentum into heat, and that's the challenge. But you know,
Here's what's astonishing to me: have you guys been watching the web videos that they've been making for The Martian? Not only just the theatrical and the
I know there were some
trailers.
Recent ones that I haven't seen those yet. Well, I've watched some of the ones that were out a while ago.
What's great is they have this savvy kind of postmodern, like if NASA was going to go to Mars with the Ares mission, they would have an extremely savvy viral marketing team that would do things like show the selection process. And in fact, the most recent video shows Matt Damon training, and there's a brief moment you could tell he's wearing Under Armour brand t-shirts or whatever, right? And it ostensibly is a promo from NASA about how they select astronauts who have the right stuff to go to Mars. And then it says Ares powered by Under Armour. So on the one hand, this is definitely a commercial for Under Armour co-sponsored with the folks making The Martian. But it ostensibly is a commercial between NASA and Under Armour, which seems to be exactly the kind of stuff that's going to happen in the future. And it looks shockingly close to the materials, this stuff right here. It's pretty great. Yeah, here we go. This oh my gosh, look at that. Yeah, they got a whole YouTube channel for the Aries live. This right here is the, you see Matt Damon working out. Scott, is that Morgan Freeman narrating it?
You'll have to make the decision to start the journey.
It's Freeman light. It's not him.
You take a step and another. Each day your journey will bring you closer to your dream.
So, and obviously, I don't think any of this shows up in the movie. This is a commercial from inside the movie universe.
But carry on, and one day, you'll be there.
And then the plug for Under Armour right there.
Does Watney give you a Peter Quill-like vibe?
Yeah, I don't think, I mean, I think that's just, yeah, I'll say that. I don't know. Anyway, I just thought that was really interesting.
Well, gentlemen, back to the subject of Mars for a moment. I'm just going to close out by saying, you know, I nuke it, do whatever. There's nothing, you know, what's the worst going to happen? And totally different news. French scientists are considering reactivating a 30,000-year-old giant virus that was discovered in Siberia.
What could go wrong?
Ain't nothing going wrong with that.
Yeah, oh. The virus known as Molyvirus sibiricum is the fourth kind of prehistoric virus unearthed overall, and the second one discovered by the research team. And it's apparently it's quite big. A giant virus has to be longer than a half micron, which is 0.0002 of an inch. By comparison, Molyvirus sibiricum clocks in at 0.6 microns. So it's kind of a big, giant thing.
So there was a...
Virus-wise.
Man, now I wish I could remember the details on it, but Radiolab, in one of the, I want to say within the last month, had an episode where they were talking with a scientist about the nature of, you know, viruses forever were considered like, you know, virus had to be smaller than the organism it infects. So, you know, obviously viruses are really, really small. And there was this entire class of giant viruses that were being misidentified as bacterium that nobody really inspected. And they only realized that they're giant, giant viruses. And apparently the overall thesis was viruses used to be huge, but as they kind of, and I'm going to use air quotes as I say, figured out the trick of injecting themselves into the host to replicate themselves, that they evolved to get smaller and smaller and smaller. So that as a result, the older the virus is, the larger it tends to be. If I'm remembering correctly, I leave that all to the Radiolab folks. But it was
tempting
really
to see a pattern there. All of our, you know, reptiles used to be bigger. Everything used to be, insects used to be bigger. Everything used to be bigger on Earth.
Well, and
until all we're left with was Texas.
We in general tend to think of things evolving as getting bigger and stronger and tougher than the other guy, but there's evolutionary pressures the other way as well.
Yeah, we have KT events keep knocking us back. We get back up again.
So do you worry about this kind of thing at all, Andrew? Do you feel like scientists know what they're doing? Go ahead and activate it. Couldn't be worse than the Ebola.
Statistically speaking, the chance of them activating a virus that could be potentially harmful to humans if it didn't come from a human host or whatever, you know, there are millions and millions of different kinds of virus. You pick up, you know, a gallon of seawater and you look inside of there, you're going to find tons of viruses, you know, lots of them, you know, and 99.999 of them are going to have no effect on us whatsoever. So statistically speaking, some random thing they pull out of the permafrost that, you know, might have an effect on us, I'm totally unqualified to tell you. I would say that, you know, we hear virus like, oh, but yeah, like there's, you know, there are a lot of, it is what we don't know. Like you pointed out the size of things, prions are a whole different thing that we didn't realize existed. And now we go, well, that's kind of nasty and stuff. I think, you know, we have to be cautious to be sure, but I don't.
Well, and that's the thing. It's like, which is the greater threat to humanity? The exact same virus temporarily locked up in some permafrost out in the open in the wild where, you know, a few sunny days can suddenly make it exposed and ready to infect whatever originally wanted to infect, or you know, that same virus in a lab with, you know, clean room conditions and built-in protocols that have a long-running history of being proved effective. You know, it's like we keep smallpox around just in case.
Yeah, they found this, I guess, in like an ancient squirrel's nest.
Of course.
So, well, maybe it can infect mammals. So
maybe squirrels should be worried. But were squirrels smaller back then? How do you have a bigger virus in a squirrel? I don't know. That's interesting. I feel like a virus that old is not going to be able to compete. Viruses have to mutate rapidly to maintain their infective vectors. And an old virus just seems like it would be left behind and be made meat of by any immune system now.
There is the idea that at some point our immune system says we don't need to remember, you know, no point in trying to store how to do this, you know, protect yourself from this. I'm very, very ignorant on the subject entirely. So, I mean, all I know is there's a lot of different kind of viruses out there, and most of them are just totally harmless to us. But, and I think they used an amoeba that came from, you know, what contact lens infections stem from to revive it. So, you know, most of your viruses just affect amoebas. So we're not an amoeba, guys. We're fine.
And the headlines on these are always, you know, kind of implying that, like, crazy scientists have giant virus and they're just going to let it loose. And that's, I mean, yeah, mistakes can happen, but my guess is that the scientists working with this virus are working very hard to make sure that it is not let loose anywhere.
Yeah.
That would infect their experiment, much less infect people.
Well, and that's the problem with science reporting is that, and I wonder how much we contribute to it. I think we couch everything in a very sensible kind of way. And we, you know, we play the game, but I think at the end of the day, we admit that we're goofballs. But, you know, science reporting skews towards the sensational. I remember when the LHC, Large Hadron Collider was going online, you know, the big thing was like, so anyway, there's an outside chance we'll create a black hole and end all of humanity. And then, you know, someone says in an offhanded comment, you know, statistically being virtually impossible, but still it's enough to, you know, I remember in the heady days of 1999 when the internet was still dial-up, that being all of the message that got to me is, the world might end, the year Y2K, it's coming.
Canned food.
Yeah.
I'm going to tell you a latest little fascination with me is I've been on a current book project. I've been researching ice ages and interglacial periods. And, you know, as we all know, we are still in an ice age. We're in an interglacial period where it gets warm. And the last, you know, the last warm period was like this?
The Holocene Maximum?
Well, we had the Eemian. So the Holocene Maximum was like at the highest point of when we had the most, you know, ice cover. So you had the Eemian was another warm period like we have now, which was when things, they got present day temperatures, the glaciers retreated and water levels were higher, actually like 9 feet higher than they were now. From a geological point of view, that was a mere 120,000 years ago.
Yeah, which is nothing.
We had a 15,000 year window of which it was as warm as it is now. At that point in time, you had Homo sapiens. At that point, as far as we know, still in Africa. They didn't get out of Africa until like 40,000 years ago. You had Neanderthals here. You had Homo erectus, and you had Homo antecessor, I think this name is, you know, which is very, very human-like species all over Europe. And, you know, you think about the idea of how many little contingent things happen that if things were a little bit differently, like in Africa, there's a people called the San people, the Sand people, S-A-N, right? And it's a culture that goes back 40,000 years. It's a very, very old culture. And these people, what they find, they dig up tools that they used, and the tools they use now or up until quite recently were like just within the last century were the same ones they used 30 or 40,000 years ago.
Yeah, that it's almost as though, you know, to call it, it was not a sentient decision almost to build these hand axes. It's just every hand axe got built the exact same way. It's just what you did. It's it no more than a bird building a nest is a sentient act of, I want to make myself a house. I want to make it a little bit bigger. Oh, I want a living room over here. They just did. It's the same way beavers build a dam. It's just instinctual. They just do it over and over again.
So yeah, here we have a very modern, sense. You know, we have modern humans who've lived the same way for so long. And because environmentally it was good enough to stay there, did not leave. When we talk about intelligent life and other things, it's important to think about that if things were slightly different, you know, if we had one isthmus that didn't get flooded or whatever,
we would have stayed in the same environment, not have a reason to really adapt because we were doing good enough. You know, that you think about one stable culture for like 40,000 years that was in, because that region wasn't as affected by the, inter, you know, the glacials as much. But then you think, you know, what could have happened 110,000 years ago, 120,000 years ago in Europe? You could have had, you know, we've pushed back because Göbekli Tepe, you know, that the monument there, we're pushing back agriculture from like 5 or 6,000 years ago to maybe 15,000 years ago, our attempts of that. You may have had attempts at that 115,000 years ago where people did this thing. And then boom, along comes the you know, the interglacial period ends and glaciers filled up and form and cover all those land masses that would have been nice places to be, getting rid of everything. And the only people who survived were hunter-gatherers eating meat.
So so what does that mean?
I have a new paleo book out. That's what it's
okay. Okay, that's where I'm headed towards. Go ahead.
It's just an interesting sort of thing to think how remarkably contingent it is that we're sitting here and, you know, electronically talk about these sort of things. We're just, you know, we don't know how many false starts we had before.
Right. Right. Well, and so here's one thing that it made me think of as you were talking about how, geologically speaking, we are all of humanity is a blip on the radar. And I'm fascinated, you know, we've grown up understanding that there's more to the magnetic spectrum than we see with our eyes. Right. There's this small band of, you know, what we call color light. And we know that there's more to it. We understand that there are bugs who can see in ultraviolet and, you know, infrared and so on. It really gives you pause when you think in terms of time. You know, picture a being for whom a year to us is a second for them. You know, they live for thousands and thousands of years. You know, for example, you know, if there is a self-contained being that can survive and have some form of consciousness as it flies through space, what must space look like to them? And recently there was on Reddit, I saw this, this amazing time lapse of a tornado, a plasma tornado, on the surface of Mars. This is a plume, a corona, coronal ejection. And if you look at it, there's no doubt in sped up form looking at it that that's a tornado. There's a tornado on the sun, which is just astonishing and hypnotic. If you just type in tornado on the sun, you'll see it.
Mm-hmm.
I could watch that all day. But I found something else this week that I wanted to share with you guys.
Yes.
Let's play a little game.
Okay.
Called "What Are We Looking At?" All right. You want to go first, Tom? What are we looking at?
Some moldy leaves.
Moldy leaves. Andrew, you got a guess?
I mean, my first instinct is to go, man, that looks like, you know, the lower jaw and the upper jaw part of like of a skull or something like that that's trapped in the ground. But then part of me goes, man, that could be the surface of, you know, Mars, you know, with ice on it, false color, you know. I mean, it's an amazing example of.
Oh, see, now that I blew it up, I see the teeth.
Yeah, right. Yeah. So now you can see the teeth. What you are looking at, and now the significant thing is that you see a bunch of these roots all around it, right?
Right.
Here's what happened. Yes, a couple days ago on. Oh no, wait. This is a long time. This is like from 3 years ago. 3 years ago.
Yes, from
on
Hurricane
Halloween.
Sandy. Okay.
So it's exactly what I thought it was.
Yeah, yeah. No, but significantly, Hurricane Sandy blew over a tree, uprooting the corpse, the skeleton of a man whose body dates all the way back to colonial times, and it's like to me. What hit me was the visceralness of, like, there's the rib cage right there.
Oh, yeah.
Can you imagine you have this lovely oak tree and then you have a rope swing on that your kids play on, you have fond memories of climbing on, and then doggone it, it gets ripped over and wrapped around, completely gnarled in the roots as if it's clutching to it, as if its soul was going straight into it, is the corpse of a skeleton.
Dude, it's
from
a heart tree.
Colonial times.
Yeah, better yet, it's an apple tree that your entire family's been eating from generations.
Yeah, Tondagas in the chat says, aw, he fed the tree.
Right, and all of those lovely stories about people who turn into trees, this is what it looks like.
Yeah, it's not pretty. Yeah, that's disturbing, and that's when you think about, you know, for this project I work on, a lot of it's, you know, it takes place in Europe and getting into the prehistory of that. And you realize that you know, I've mentioned this before, like I have like some Neanderthal hand axes and stuff, which aren't that expensive because, you know, these guys were making them for, you know, 500,000 years, you know, that they were continuously producing these things. And you start looking at, it's fascinating when you look at, you'll hear, oh, you know, this, you know, well, here's what's cool about the rise of like the Mayans or whatever. And you look at like, you know, when did, you know, Mayans, when was the height of the Mayan civilization, right? And you realize that, you know, the Mayans were building their, you know, kind of a pseudo pyramids, kind of like, you know, like, you know, I don't know. The first Mayan city started in 750 BC. You know, you already had Greek philosophers and all that extrapolating on stuff and documenting things pretty well. And then, you know, not too long after, you know, you had the Egyptian empires were already kind of, you know, in their later years and whatnot. Point is you look at these things, it's so ancient, but then we find things that are 10,000 years old and things that might be 15,000 years old. And then the idea that we find little remnants of things that maybe even further back.
Do you think that we're cursed to always have to just speculate, or do you think that due to techniques and technology and I don't know, new theories, that we're going to get how clear a picture do you think we could possibly get of humanity more than 10,000 years ago? Do you think we'll ever really know, or do you think we'll it'll be like the Big Bang where it's like, well, we have models that suggest blank, blank, blank?
The biggest boon in recent times has been genetics, has been DNA. And we can, a haploid group is basically when a mutation appears in a group, a random mutation, and then you can see, you can pretty much figure out when that happened, you can track how that mutation spread. That has been wonderful because all of a sudden we have ways to look at present day populations and we can look and see where do they migrate from, where do they come from, and that's been able to sort so much of the myth from reality. But there's a great, you know, our friends who do OpenROV, they have a project on Kickstarter coming out tomorrow or this week, which is a brand new Trident, you know, underwater submersible robot, which if you start having, if you get hundreds of people taking to those places where they're now submerged, you know, will we find cool things? Maybe. And I've been, you know, you look at, like, there's a legendary city called Ys, which was supposed to have been submerged, you know, in Europe after, you know, the daughter of the king slept with the devil and gave him the key to unlock the gates that led in the ocean or whatever.
Yeah. Yeah. Why do you got a slut shame like that? She could sleep with whoever she wants, devil or no devil.
It's basically a different version of like Sodom and Gomorrah, but. You know, you'd find out that, oh, yeah, no, like, you know, Dunwich in England, oh, yeah, half of that already actually sunk into the sea through erosion, that there was an entire medieval port built on top of a sandbank, you know, in the 14th century, that then one big storm came through and wiped away. And you start finding a lot of these accounts. You know, during the Roman eras, the Scilly, islands in the very tip of the British Isles, we're probably a solid landmass. You know, we find remnants of a farm there where there just wasn't enough land for a farm. And so this was within time, characters we talk about, Caesar and other people, that there was a very different geography there. So as far as, you know, finding this stuff out again, underwater archaeology will be a big boom. Being able to dig unintrusively or minimally intrusively in other places is going to be helpful. You know, Göbekli Tepe, that amazing site, which maybe dates back 15,000 years or more with stones that weigh 50 tons, we've only uncovered 5% of it. So I think that we will get a better picture than we have now. I think that we will get a better picture of the spread.
And as a matter of fact, it's funny you mentioned that, because using those techniques, those non-invasive, you know, ground radar kind of things, just the other day I saw a super Stonehenge 15 times bigger than the actual Stonehenge found 2 miles away. That's amazing. And
not an auditorium, but what did they call it? Like it was like an event space near Stonehenge.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
So
that's why archaeologists were describing it as a place to like gather and do ceremonies and such.
Am I right in understanding that Stonehenge, when it was discovered within the last couple of centuries, did not have a single stone balanced on other stones, that all of our pictures of Stonehenge were created in the earlier 20th century?
I don't know. I don't remember hearing that.
Hey, let me see if I can find that. let's see, Stonehenge.
I mean, Stonehenge wasn't discovered. It's been known in England continuously for a long time.
Right, but the place.
It may have been known to have the stones erect and then they fell over and somebody put them back.
Here it is, yeah. How they rebuilt Stonehenge. So, well, I don't know if I'm looking at a reliable source or not.
Yeah.
But we're seeing what appears to be photos.
I mean, like, why not just rebuild the whole thing then?
Well, I think, yeah, it was right. Picture shows workers on the site in 1901 and a restoration which caused outrage at the time, but is rarely referred to in official guidebooks. So that for it means that Stonehenge, jewel in the crown of Britain's heritage industry, is not all it seems. Much of what the ancient site's millions of visitors see, in fact, dates back less than 50 years. And then there are photos of them setting rocks back on top to make it look more Stonehenge-y. From 1954.
Well, it all depends on how they went about it. Were they going on reliable drawings from people who said it was like this, and they're just restoring it and putting it back where it obviously fit, or did they just slap it on top and go, "We think it was like that"?
I'm gonna assume that they did it responsibly. So this is a 1954 reconstruction. There's another photo from it says the 18th July 1877, but I don't know.
The oldest detailed drawing of Stonehenge has turned up in a 15th century manuscript.
Right. So there have been persistent, representations of it. But, interesting. Here we go. Here's a photo of a contemporary newspaper depiction of the 1920 restoration. So apparently they've been rebuilding Stonehenge over and over and over again through the years, just kind of being stewards of like, well, that rock fell over. Let's put it back on top.
I think... Like, listen, Stonehenge is kind of neat. It's interesting. And, I've read some neat historical sort of novels that talk about that kind of thing. But, compare that to, Göbekli Tepe, which is, 10,000 years older than that and far more advanced, far more ornate carvings, whatever. It's like, yeah, it's great that those hillbillies made that 10,000 years after. It's the G-O is in like Dunar or whatever, Göbekli Tepe. I'll gmail you this.
First thing that came up, I wrote G-O-B and it said Göbekli Tepe.
One of your idiot friends searches for it too much. You go look at what they built there. 50-ton blocks, carved stuff, animals, three-dimensional animal representations, all this. And it may have been, the present site is 10,000 millennia BCE, so 12,000 years ago. Stonehenge is 4,500 years old. So, and then there are parts of this that they think are even older, like 15,000 years. So, it is insane. It's absolutely crazy. It makes Stonehenge look like a bunch of just drunken hillbillies went out there and piled some rocks on top of each other.
Which, let's face it, not too far off. I mean, that could be accurate.
And I'm talking about my people, too, understand.
Right? I mean, there's nothing wrong with drunken hillbillies going out and setting stones up for whatever reason. It's pretty awesome.
Yeah. Well, and what I love is I love the fact that we still do nutty stuff like this, stuff that will hopefully last ages and ages. Do we know how long the shelf life on something like, say, Mount Rushmore is, or even a Statue of Liberty? How long is the Statue of Liberty going to hang for, you think?
That's a good question.
I've seen Planet of the Apes, so I assume it
lasts. I've seen this historical documentary, The Planet of the Apes.
Well, and so let's take Mount Rushmore and let's take Statue of Liberty as they are right now, okay? And let's just say that everybody on the planet just gets up and vanishes. What's going to happen? And they have I think Discovery Channel or somebody did a really cool Earth After or what after people, and they show what happens to this. And you're going to get eventually, if following history as it's gone happened before. Our ice caps, everything's going to start to increase again. This interglacial will come to an end, and you look at the long history of the Earth, and it's warm now. It was warm before, have these little bits of warm periods, but up in these latitudes that we enjoy, they don't stay that way. you're going to get these increasing, you know, ice caps. These things are going to croach. The glaciers are going to go through there. All the parts like New York City, most of Europe, whatever, is going to get covered in ice. It's going to wear away this sort of stuff. And that's not going to be every place that we have these sort of monuments. But, you know, eventually it'll be ground under, you know. But places that don't have to face glaciers might be different.
We see. I guess Mount Rushmore would be in an interesting position because, as Sunglow is saying from a government website, Mount Rushmore is estimated to erode 1 inch every 10,000 years. I'm assuming that's absent giant glaciers rolling over it.
Sure.
I would imagine once we get to that, you're going to see some flattening real
quick. It's non-glacier erosion.
Yeah. Which again goes back to that looking at the solar tornado. It's like on a fast enough timeline. You know, rivers of ice just flowing super fast over stuff will destroy it.
When you'll get in other latitudes, you're going to get what will happen is you'll have, let's say, carved stones and things like that that kind of last the longest. They're going to lose their features. And, you know, we find mysterious rocks and stones now that maybe kind of look like they could have been the foot from the giant and lost, you know?
Yeah.
Have either of you read Seven Eves by Neal Stephenson?
Yes, I have. Have you read Seven Eves yet?
Mm-mm.
Okay, so not too spoilery, but if you want to be 100% spoiled, maybe close your ears. One of the main plot points, premises of the book, is that the Earth gets annihilated by rocks hitting it, and humanity has to figure out how to survive because the surface is unlivable, which has happened previously in Earth's history. Is it possible that Earth had a, you know, prodigious scientific advancement and that got wiped out and we would have no record of it because it would just melt?
So you're talking about ancient advanced civilizations, right? I mean,
I don't know that we ever had a period of long enough habitability back
to get that far ahead.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, that's why I brought up the Eemian before. So the Eemian age was very much like this one, you know, got very, very warm and you had hominid-wise Neanderthals, Homo sapiens, various Homo erectus, you know, descendants, Denisovians, all these. You had like 7 or 8 different intelligent tool users around and present there.
Middle Earth.
If somebody had built a Roman-level civilization, you know, roads and cultivations, agriculture, armies, and all of that in Europe, I don't think that we would be aware that it existed today.
And you're talking about if we go back like 100,000 years.
Period, 115,000 years. I don't think we would be aware that it existed.
So let's say what we have right now, what would you say definitively you're certain would last 100,000 years? Of, let's say, 3 severe ice ages and 3 warming periods, and then humanity rises again. What do you think they'd run across?
Highways with concrete and rebar.
So, okay, you think those would survive all that time?
Well, they'll get broken up and busted, but you're going to find worked metal, and it could be very rusted and worked out, but inside that.
Well, and it's funny you should mention that in A Canticle for Leibowitz, that's one of the minor plot points, is that there are these people who hunt around for the special rocks that have valuable iron buried inside that was placed there by the before times.
Yeah.
And it's clear they're talking about rebar.
Yeah. I mean, I think that would be because our civilization's so large now, we don't have any reason to ever think that we reach this many people. There's going to be so many fragments and stuff. But if you dial it back to, the habit we have too is we keep building things on top of each other. You know, we've looked underneath Roman forts and found older cities that they're like, great place, already got the stones, let's build it there. You know, you have churches in England, in Europe, that the stones that they used to make those churches were for pagan temples at one point. And that's, you know, the places that are good places to live. And but it's weird too, because there is this habit of, and we haven't quite, you take place at Mohenjo-Daro and then Göbekli, which is my favorite, they get covered over. For some reason, people come along and they just bury them.
I mean, do you think it's just like, well, this is poor real estate, let's cover it up and make it valuable real estate that we could build upon?
I think that it might be a sign that what happens is that these places tend to, as things are good and you have so much surplus energy and effort that you can start building a city or start to build something like that, you do that. But then as things collapse, if your agriculture there collapses, and you look at all the little mini, you know, problems we've had within our own climate in the last 10,000 years of cold periods, whatever, and crops failing and civilization essentially failing, it might be a thing where, like, let's bury this because this was led us to wickedness, or you know, or it could be conquerors come in there and say, well, you know, look what happens with ISIS when they go in there and they find these thousands of old artifacts
that, like, in Palmyra, right?
Yeah, it's horrifying. So, I don't have an easy answer. I don't. That looks like a really cool link there. I can't wait to see what this is.
This London Hammer here. It says here, this is from Mech in the chat room. He says that sent us a Wikipedia article that says the London Hammer is a name given to a hammer made of iron and wood that was found in London, Texas in 1936. Part of the hammer is embedded in a limey rock concretion, leading it to be hailed in some quarters as an anomalous artifact. It is, if an obviously man-made tool is old enough to have been encased in rock, the argument goes, then conventional history is wrong. And unfortunately, it's not a very big photo.
First of all, insensitive to call a London hammer in a limey rock. But if it's limestone, it doesn't take that much to get embedded.
Well, and plus also, can't limestone dissolve and reform or whatever?
You know, it might be kind of a foundation for which we build many, many things.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Concrete.
It should be easy to test the age of that hammer too, wouldn't you think?
Hang on, let me back up to the rest of the article and see what it says. But apparently, it's hailed by
listed sources may not be reliable.
Yeah.
It says.
Creationist Carl Ball referenced the hammer in the 1980s, using it as the basis of speculation of how the atmospheric quality of a plea. Blah 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 blah. The metal hammerhead is approximately 6 inches long, has a diameter of 1 inch, leading some to suggest that this hammer was not used for large projects, but rather for fine work or soft metal. The metal of the hammerhead has been confirmed to consist of 96.6% iron, some chlorine, and some sulfur. The hammerhead has not rusted since its discovery in the mid-1930s. Anomalous.
That happens when you put a layer of rust on top of something.
Yeah, right? It stops being, the oxygen stops being able to access it. Let's see. Other observers have noted that the hammer is stylistically consistent with typical American tools manufactured in the late 1800s. One possible explanation is that the highly soluble minerals in the ancient limestone, nailed it, may have formed a concretion around the object, a common process like that of a petrifying well, which often creates similar incrustations around fossils and other nuclei. Yep. Yeah, that makes sense to me.
Yeah.
Somebody just dropped a hammer.
Yeah, exactly. J.R. Cole says, the stone is real and it looks impressive to someone unfamiliar with geological processes. How could a modern artifact be stuck in Ordovician rock? The answer is that concretion itself is not Ordovician.
The answer may surprise you.
You won't believe what happens next.
There is all those sort of, there's like, you know, the Barry Fell books and all that. There was all these sort of very rather flimsy books describing things to try to make a case of, I have a problem with the idea of there being these big, huge civilizations 5 or 6,000 years ago that were that level, or 10,000 years ago even, that were as massive as we describe, because we would have it. And we do find certain things there, like Gobleki, but like really, really Roman era stuff. I think you would find, you know, we can find from the Romans, we can find, you know, their lead mines or where they're processing lead. We can find the pollution in the ocean. We can find sedimentary tracks from where that came from. And so I think there probably was very, very big interconnected civilizations that, you know, you look at the mound people in the Americas, you know, we have these mounds all over the place, which are kind of cool, but I don't think they're riding around in chariots and stuff.
What about plastic? Doesn't plastic last longer?
Not as long as some fearmongers would have you believe.
I'm talking about that, but it's just archaeologically. Like, if someone had developed plastic pre-Roman times,
and if
we should
have buried and it was not exposed to the elements, because I know in, you know, even in just direct sunlight, it breaks down fairly quickly, geologically speaking.
Yeah, I think, I don't think, you know, if we're talking tens of thousands of years, I don't think so. You're going to, thing's going to find it and eat
it. Dust, yeah.
But I mean, there would be, you know, it at what level does it become more, you know, like I mentioned rebar. Once you're making steel and you're putting it inside of concrete and you're doing that, then that gets to be something. You find a fragment of something here, like
radioactive materials.
True, and that's that. But if you're assuming that we got to that level, I mean, I don't think we need to get to radioactive levels, you know, radiation before we find some things that would be left behind. But
sure,
you know, if the Egyptians had built their pyramids, you know, they'd been around 100,000 years ago, and they built them in northern Europe, and the glaciers came through, we would find a very interesting smattering of rocks that we might find some sharp edges to. We'd be going,
It's really interesting because you get this weird kind of countercultural desire to make humans in prehistory something other than what they most likely appear to be. And that goes for, let's just say on the intelligence side of things, we either want to make them crazy smart, indicating that they had advanced civilizations and that their hubris brought them down and then they got wiped off the planet of the Earth, or we want to insist that they're so dumb they couldn't possibly have figured certain things out on their own, and therefore aliens must have come down and taught them how to make pyramids. Or are you familiar with the Dogon people of Mali in West Africa? Do you know about this?
Yeah.
There's a tribe, and this is from a book that this guy Robert Temple wrote a while ago called The Serious Mystery, where his case for ancient astronomers was that the Dogon people of Mali are they knew about Sirius B, a companion star in the Sirius system, and therefore no way these backwoods tribal people could know that stuff. Right. And then when in fact it just boils down to you know that they're observant, they've got their own culture, and that they've been watching those stars for years.
At some point they had a strong tradition of astronomy that observe Sirius B.
Yes, exactly. Right? Although it's, I think that the crux of the argument is that it can't be seen with the naked eye. Let me see.
Well,
the more fascinating ancient discoveries are the ones that show not that they were super smart or that they were super dumb, but that they came close or even surpassed later cultures somehow and then fell back. Because that seems to make sense to me, is that we advance and then we pull back, and then we advance and then we pull back. But we never fall far enough back that, you know, we fall all the way back. So it would make sense that you'll see kind of startling progress, but not super progress in the past.
And also, just on the James Oberg, who's had the pleasure of talking to a few times, he went in and pointed out that they were wrong about so many things.
Oh, they just happen to be right about it being a binary system. Yeah,
and there's evidence that they'd had conversations with other people about it. And it's a neat, you know, if you want to go talk to a people, if you're a missionary or somebody else, what do you talk about? Like, oh, well, this is interesting.
As a matter of fact, here from a quote from Skeptical Inquirer in 1978, astronomer Ian Ridpath said, "The whole Dogon legend of Sirius and its companions is riddled with ambiguities, contradictions, and downright errors, at least if we try to interpret it literally." Ridpath stated that the information that the Dogons had probably gained from Europeans to some extent resembles the facts about Sirius. The presumed original Dogon knowledge of the star is very far from the facts. So it's one of those things where it's like, you know, yeah, if you believe that this tribe never had contact with anyone who had heard of you know, a telescope, then sure, yeah, that would be amazing.
It's such a cool story. It's such a cool story.
And that's the secret of all great pseudosciences, is take something novel, remove just one piece of it. Like, you know, it is genuinely amazing that this tribe cares enough about Sirius to have legends of it having a twin and so on. And if you just remove that little part that they traded with Europeans, or that, you know, people communicate over thousands of years and that knowledge, you know, stories progress or whatever. If you isolate that and say, no, that never happened, there's no evidence that they ever traded with anyone, all of a sudden you have what is a curiosity becomes a downright miracle just at the flip of a coin.
And it's weird, too, because, like, how much little we know of recent history. You know, we talk about, like, the Vikings going to, let's say, Iceland, and the reports that there were already Irish monks living there. And there's a little bit of evidence to that, whatever. The fact that we don't even know for sure, were they there, were they not there, how far did they go, and, you know, a better appreciation of the fact that the Vikings had been to the Americas and actually did a lot more than we realized, and it's like, oh, these things change. All right, one more thing where we do picks, which is kind of like, if you want to talk about how crazy legends and things like that can start, are you familiar with the Vadoma people?
No.
Ever heard of the ostrich people?
No.
I've heard tell of ostrich people.
Google search on ostrich people.
Ostrich people.
Oh, why do I know ostrich people?
Hold on. Oh my goodness. The Vadoma people just brought something up. Can I click on that?
Yep.
VADOMA is what you want to look at, and apparently they have fascinating feet.
Yeah. It's a tribe living in North Zimbabwe, and they have a very, very high incidence of a condition known as electrodactylial, or dactyly, which causes the middle three toes are absent and the two outer ones are turned in and very large size. They have feet that look like ostrich feet.
So, and do they have...
Or lobster claw syndrome.
Do they have any trouble walking on them?
Apparently, they're able to quite ambulatory. It's not even really considered a defect there because they walk around and they're just as functional as anybody else.
And everyone they know has that same thing.
This is amazing because this is, of course, you know, this is real life evolution in action. This is how you have this isolated population that this continues to happen, and in this environment, for all we know, this is a superior, more useful way to get around and could eventually evolve in that direction.
Possibly,
they take people who are born with five toes and like bind up their toes because they're disabled? Like, your toes are all separated.
I think that it's still a minority position where people have this condition there, but it's so common that it's just considered a, you know, no big whoop. But yeah, it's an example. Like you think of a lot of the crazy stories you'd hear about ancient peoples and other things, you know, that you just go like, we would just discount like, oh, I was a traveler and I was in Africa and I saw people who had feet like birds. I'm like, all right, crazy story. Let's just count that one as not true.
Yeah, Neshcom points out in the chat, he gives a quote, I don't know where from. Some have theorized that the mutation may have adaptive benefits if it aids in tree climbing. It's more likely, however, that the defect remains prevalent because of a small genetic pool among the Vadoma. It is against tribal law for members to marry outside of the group. That's interesting.
Yeah. A little bit of reinforcement there.
But then tribal law could be a genetic adaptation to make sure that you keep getting the tree climbing feet.
Isn't that weird? How cultural, like it's the chicken and egg thing, right? It's
we forget that our cultural stuff is dictated by us. It's not, it doesn't come from outside, so it's dictated by the same genetic manipulations that are making us do anything.
That is fascinating. Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely look it up because I hesitate to call anyone a noun people, but I can understand why people would think of it as they definitely resemble ostrich feet.
Yeah, and it's not a nice term to call them that. But, yeah, it's the Vadoma. We'll call them the Vadoma.
Yeah. Hey, so for picks, I got a quick one here. It's always a crapshoot when somebody gives you something early and asks you to take a look at it and please talk about it. And it is an awesome delight when you get something early and it in every way surpasses your farthest hopes, dreams, and expectations. And that is exactly what happened to at least two members of this panel when the fine folks over at Sphero gave us an early, you know, is he grabbing one?
All of a sudden,
Andrew.
No,
just
I don't have it.
Okay. The folks over at Sphero sent us early units of their BB-8 droid. It's a miniature version of the droid of the same name from the upcoming Star Wars movie. I don't know if you've heard of it, The Phantom Menace. And it's amazing. It over-delivered in every possible way. As a matter of fact, if you just search, Brian Brushwood BB-8, you'll be able to see like the 45-minute unboxing that we did. And there's several moments when it utterly surprised and delighted me with stuff. They went the extra mile in so many ways. The packaging is beautiful. It's fast. It's responsive. It comes fully charged. It makes sounds. It talks to you. It's got emotes that you can have it, you know, say yes or no.
I don't know that it came fully charged, but it came charged enough.
Well, it works straight out of the box, basically.
Yeah.
You know. And the head stays on straight and can turn and look in different directions and zip forward. And then they put in this cute augmented reality holographic display.
That was the only part that disappointed me.
Oh, really?
Because I expected it to actually project onto the floor. I knew it wasn't going to really be a hologram, but I thought there might be some kind of projection.
Oh, but I assume you knew there was some hologram aspect to it.
Yeah.
Because I did not. That was
and
just
then
like
the fact that you have to look at it through your phone and then you see it. I was like, it's not quite as good.
I did not know that was in there. I expected nothing more than a remote control ball droid.
Well, I just read it on the box. That's all.
You see, I didn't read that. I did like a 12-year-old at Christmas. I just opened it up and started pressing buttons. It's fantastic.
Let me ask you a question.
Huh?
Mm. I saw Tom's. It was cool. Watched it roll around on the floor. I love robots. Like, nobody loves robots more than me. Okay? Let me make that very clear. But I'm going, I asked myself, like, 10 minutes later.
Well, it's, I mean, it's like any remote control thing. I mean, you could say the same thing about a remote control car. It's like, you know.
Which I don't own.
Well, exactly. But I mean, it's, 10 minutes later, Tom and I are at Dragon Con having the world's first BB-8 cockfight.
BB-8 fight.
Complete with money on the table. And one of them, and we can verify at Dragon Con, two BB-8s entered and only one left.
Yes, that's true. Literally true.
It's like any other remote control gizmo, and I think at $150, it's just the right price point. You get a real sense of quality about it. It seemed pretty tough. We were banging it around. It fell off the table a few times, and its head went rolling away. You just pop it back on. I think it's a fine gift for this upcoming holiday season, and it was a real treat to, you know, not be in that awkward position of getting something early that you're like, I don't really like this, but instead just. I was blown away. Yeah. I thought it was great.
No, it looks neat. I mean, it looks really, really cool. I just, like, I feel guilty when friends give me things like that because, like, I'll play with it for 10 minutes, then I'm like,
and I'm done.
That's a waste of money for me, you know?
Sure. Like, but it's amazing because you know, Spiro's been on our radar for a while, and I've always watched the videos. I'm like, yeah, that looks cool. That looks cool. But for some reason, you know, you just staple a little bit of Star Wars character onto it.
Yeah, play some Star Wars music on the app.
Yeah,
I had when I was a kid. I had there was a remote control ball called Orb, I think it was, and that was fun. That was kind of cool because it was like kind of like my own little gollywog magic trick. That was a fun sort of thing that I played with for a little bit. It was no BB-8, but. You know.
Anyway, that's my pick if and when cool. You find yourself an opportunity to get one.
Tom?
My pick really, honestly, should be Kino Flow replacement bulbs because that saved my life right before this show, the fact that I'd pre-ordered them before because my bulbs went out. But no, you know, I don't know. Did you guys pick Seven Eves before? Because I'm in the midst of it and I'm loving it.
I mentioned
you're
it. How far into it are you?
80%. Through.
Oh wow! Okay, so you're past the and I don't think it's a spoiler to say that the end of the second act is bleak.
Yeah,
like that rough. Like the whole middle act. And traditionally, that's when protagonists run into trouble. They run into a lot of trouble.
Yeah, the human race does. Well, I'm fascinated by it. It sometimes it gets a little bit. As Neal Stephenson can, lost in its details, where he shows off the research that he did. And so there are parts where I'm like, okay, this is interesting, but not moving my story forward as much as I would like. But those parts are always well worth it because, as I told Patrick Norton, instead of Chekhov's gun, Neal Stephenson does Stephenson's long description of the development of ammo.
Yes.
And you're like, okay, I know I'm going through this because this is going to be really important in an upcoming scene.
Chekhov's explanation of orbital mechanics.
Yeah, exactly, right? So I feel like he couldn't have done this without doing the Baroque cycle and Anathem first, but it really shows like what a writer who continually pushes himself and tries to come up with new and interesting ways of telling stories can do. And it bears on a lot of the themes that we were talking about today about, you know, survival of humanity and technology and et cetera.
Yeah. If I can real quick throw a plug in, this should have been my pick, but the hardcover or the soft cover print edition of Scam School
Academy.
That's
great, Brian. Why don't you go do that pick too?
Oh,
that's fantastic.
Oh, wait, were you going to do that? Oh,
good. Get as many picks as you need, Brian, because my pick doesn't matter.
I'm sorry.
Brian.
No, take what's your pick, Andrew
Nope.
Maine?
That's what I went to get when we said picks. But it's much better if you pick your own book, Brian.
No, I just forgot to plug it, and then but I didn't know if you were going to mention it. That's
you didn't have confidence in me.
No, I should have. I'm bad.
Your first reviewer on Amazon, by the way.
That's right. That's right. So what did you say?
I 1 star. No, it's fantastic. So those of you that don't know what we're talking about, obviously because you know you probably listen to this on audio, I am holding a copy of Scam School Academy, the actual published book. And I'm going to admit, your cover's a little bit harder than my cover. I have a paperback, but this is kind of a...
It's a flexi-bound, yeah.
Semi-hard cover back edition. It looks like a Brian's notebook from school, although it's like spelled correctly and we can understand things. And it is a wonderful collection of all sorts of great scam school bids and stuff to pull on people, ranging from chess to cards and to other things. And they have accompanying it are QR codes, which if you want, and it makes sense, it really makes sense in the context of this book, because if you're going to want to go through it over and over again, you take out your phone, you scan it, and you get an audio commentary from Brian, you get an episode, if it appears in an episode, all this great information. It is a beautiful, beautiful book. Very well. You should be very proud of yourself, Brian.
Well, thank you.
Filled with so many cool little bits in there. And it can be purchased relatively inexpensively and signed, too, if you go to Scam Stuff.
Yeah,
right?
ScamStuff.com. You could get it at it's so funny because I knew that theoretically you'd be able to buy it in bookstores. And I make the comment, like, go to your local bookstore. But then I started getting photos of people who went to their local bookstore and found it on the shelf. And then it hit me. I was like, whoa, it's a real book. Of
and
course.
You got to tell them, yeah, better yet, take a photo of it outside the bookstore with a receipt.
It's fine. But the big thing is, if you do buy it from scamstuff.com, we got the first 500 units that are signed and numbered on there. And I think we're down to like the last 100 or so. It's been a pretty busy weekend.
So it is currently the number 26 best-selling book in Magic right now.
What? That's awesome.
And can I tell you, there's only one review. Guys, get on that.
Yeah.
There's only one review by me. I think other people should go there and give
them. I mean, unless more reviews will just take away our 5-star rating, in which case, let's not.
That's true.
We can just keep it 5 stars.
Here's a simple fact, folks. If you want to help Brian, and that's a big if, admittedly, if you want to help Brian, you want to help this book.
It's a personal decision.
The more he sells of this book with a traditional publisher, increases his leveraging potential bargaining position with other publishers and other book deals. Amazon sales matter. The more people who buy and more people who review it, if you start giving enough good reviews to something, it starts to have some mojo. It's like its own Google rank. There's its own page rank that applies to Amazon books based in part by reviews, how well it's reviewed, what else you purchase when you buy it. So support Brian. Buy a copy from Brian that's signed for yourself. Buy a copy from here. It's dirt cheap. If you have Amazon Prime, you can have this thing delivered to you like Tuesday. There's only 4 left in stock. Make them reorder it.
Oh, yeah. But, no, they definitely notice when they keep getting more and more reorder things.
Yeah, it's pleasing to me to think back to hearing Brian talking about like, hey, buy Cheats, Cons, Swindles, and Tricks at the end of the early scam schools, and to see this glorious, beautiful Scam School Academy book. It's amazing.
Right on, guys. It's
just wonderful.
So
again, guys, seriously, get this book and just look at the pretty pictures and tell Amazon how wonderful it is and give them 5 stars and rank it highly. Buy a lot of them. I mean, I don't care. If you're trying to pay for your daughter's surgery, she's going to be really bored in the hospital, and you'll have to entertain her. So,
all right.
So
awesome! Thank you very much, Andrew. That was
and like my review, so I can always have the number one review on Brian's thing, and then I can go back and change it at some point if he displeases me.
Oh, that was great. Was it helpful to you? Yes, it totally was.
I love it. I'm going to be going through there looking. I'm like, I need something fun, bitter, whatever.
Well, and keep in mind, your contribution is in there. A couple, I think the napkin one and the
we made up in front of you.
The vanishing sugar packet one is on there as well.
Fantastic. So there you go. I don't remember assigning any rights to this. Anyhow, gentlemen, it's been weird.
Okay, I got a good 20 or 30 minutes I could do after things.
Okay, want to just roll right into it?
Cool, yeah. Tom, are you familiar with the after things stuff?
Sort of.
Okay, you explain it, Andrew. I'm going to run to the restroom.
So, Tom, after things is more of a podcast for creative professionals or people, creatives, and just, thoughts and whatever kind of topic. And, we throw out there. Sometimes we get some questions in the chat room. Sometimes people email us stuff. Or most of the time we just sort of make it up as we go along.
Sure.
And,
I am sometimes considered creative and occasionally professional.
You are extremely proficiently creative. You are a guy that gets up every day and creates multiple bits of content. So, kind of a hero.
Remember, folks, you don't have to be good to be creative.
Fortunately, you're both.
Thanks.
I think I've used you as an example when I talk to people about just the somebody who I know is hardworking. You know, the hard work comes ahead of the entrepreneurial nature, I'll say. More of a...
I would agree.
Yeah, and to show that, like, you can still succeed and do really well, even if you're not like, well, here's my, you know, here's how I'm going to build my empire kind of thing. It's more like, here's how I'm going to create a great thing. Here's how I'm going to keep creating a great thing, and here's how hopefully I'll reach out to my audience and learn how to do that, which I think is kind of a probably a much more fulfilling sort of route to it, too, because if your goal is the product, then you're not going to be disappointed.
Yeah, right. It's a... I don't want to say it's a lifestyle choice, but it's an approach choice. It's, mm-hmm. you know, because some people get really excited about the idea of pushing that ball towards the goal line, right? And they don't care as much. They may care about the ball, but they're like, what really gets them going, gets them up anymore is like, how do I market? How do I push? How do I achieve? How do I move forward? And for me, it's more about like, I just want to make a really good ball, and pushing it forward is all for me. A product of like, well, I want people to see the ball, you know, and so I need to do that in service of that. Otherwise, why did I make it?
You know, and absolutely, people get caught up on, I want to have a, what should my book cover look like? You know what? What should your book read like?
Yeah.
And that, you know, they get more focused on the trophy than, you know, they do on the actual work itself. And I tell people repeatedly is you've got to be in love with the work. You know, not where you think it'll get you, because it'll never get you at there. You're going to be well exhausted long before you ever reach that point.
Yeah, especially when people are asking about podcasting and they start immediately asking, like, what equipment should I buy? Or, you know, how do I get people to listen to my podcast? I always ask them, well, what is your podcast? And if they have that, then great. Then they're on the right track. A lot of times they're like, well, I haven't quite nailed that down. I'm like, just back up. Figure out your thing first.
Speaking about backing up, you want back up and we'll start officially?
Yep, ready?
Yep, ready.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to After Things, the podcast that comes after Weird Things, where we talk about being a creative, trying to work in this world. Joining us are, you know, my co-hosts, who've always been my co-hosts, Tom Merritt.
It's great to be here again, Andrew, as always.
Brian Brushwood.
Indeed it is. What do you think of the use of the word creative as a noun? Being a creative, I think it's been fairly recently that I've heard it used that way, but I like it. I'm okay with that.
Are you nouning an adjective when you do that?
I think I am. Yeah.
I think it fits because there are so many areas that overlap. And so you take, okay, Tom's a guy, gets up every day, records multiple podcasts, and may not... And again, Tom's a writer too, whatever, but Tom's main thing is Tom is going to, you know, do these interviews, put together these shows and do that sort of thing and create this content that other than the day of doesn't know where it's going to come from, but then generates this massive content. You know, my day is, and I want to talk a little bit, like I sit down at a keyboard and I have an outline. I'm going to make this thing called a book. I'm going to make this sort of thing called book. And there is so much overlap between those kinds of worlds. And if you're an actor, you know, you're a creative and you say, okay, I'm going to go be part of a creative enterprise. I'm going to go do this. And there's going to be, you know, I think it's a helpful thing that sort of it explains the overlap.
So all three of us, I think, have had wildly diverse. We seem to dabble in a lot of different things. I would say Tom is the most specialized. No, because you are mainly forward facing as a news aggregator and presenter and not pundit.
Analyst, pundit,
analyst,
whatever.
There you go. That's the word I'm looking for. But and yet you have this completely other artistic field where you write books and you know outside of that what other pies do you got your fingers in?
Well, can I throw in one too?
Yep.
When he does FSL.
Yes. Oh, that's right. Yeah, you may not think of it this way, but you're a comedian.
The show.
Yeah, yeah, you're a comedian in that show, and I know that's a weird thing to be told, but yeah, it's
my paintings, you know, and Wait. Sketches. No, I'm just kidding.
I was about to say, do you have paintings?
My tattoos I design.
No, there are definitely things that I do not consider myself any good at, and painting is one of them.
How important is it, as a kickoff question, do you guys think it is to have more than one domain that you're good at? And, you know, this is obviously not a new idea. We would watch Frank Sinatra sing, and then suddenly he's an actor. He's in movies and so on. And, you know, we see Mario Lopez is an actor, and now all of a sudden he's a news correspondent for Extra or whatever.
Important for what?
That's a good question. You know, to have a successful career as a creative, mm-hmm. I guess.
Because I feel like it is important as a well-rounded human being, mm-hmm. to try to experience lots of different things, some of which you will become better at, some of which you won't. But there are certain things that you know you're a little bit better at, and you can just devote more time. The more time you devote to anything, the better you'll get at it. And so I think it's important as a human being to try lots of different things and try to get better at the ones you like. For your career, that's a whole different question, because there's an argument that if you do too many different things, you'll never build up momentum enough in one of them. But at the same time, if you're Frank Sinatra and you've built up this huge momentum in singing, then it might be just as important for you to diversify and say, hey, I can also be an actor in this and that, so that you're not putting all of your eggs in one basket if your voice blows out like it did on him in the late 40s.
Well, so Andrew, Tom is kind of gently dovetailing into something that I talked to him about. I sort of worked out one of the two presentations I gave out in Kuala Lumpur. One was this loose idea I had that there's sort of an endless cycle of, I brought everything in my career back to street performing. When I started, I had neither a product nor a platform. And I had a loose idea for a product. I had a couple of routines I knew how to do. I had like 20 minutes of material, but I needed a platform. And, you know, since nobody was hiring me, I had no, you know, pre-internet stuff. I guess I could have tried to have done cable access, as many people did. But I knew that all of the great magicians that I respected had started off street performing. So I was like, well, you know, I'm going to go out on the street and perform. Ain't nobody can tell me no, except for the cops, who eventually did. And you know, if somebody likes it, they can throw me some money. And it was a great process during which I refined the product. And once I had product, I needed to find a bigger platform than the streets. And so, you know, I mailed postcards. I did direct response mailing. I did cold calling. I went to conferences. I showed up on doorsteps. And eventually, flash forward 4 years later, I had a success. You know, I was touring 150, 200 days out of the year. And at some point, that was the product. The product was the college stage show. But when I wanted to start something new, when I wrote the Skeptic Lectures, Scam, Sasquatch, and the Supernatural, what was the product was suddenly the platform. That was the way I could sell the new lecture, because everyone knew me as the guy who toured around those colleges. And then because I was that guy, I was able to get the word out and sell this lecture. And then from there, that product eventually became a platform from which I could pitch a TV project to Court TV that eventually fizzled, but gave rise to Scam School. And so again, the platform of being a college performer, which again, those were products, now they were platform, was what I used to encourage everyone to check out Scam School. Flash forward, you know, 4 or 5 more years, Scam School is now very popular, fairly popular. And it, what was the product, the thing I was trying to get people to try and experience, is now the platform that allows us to launch the Scam School book and eventually Scam Stuff. And rapidly, Scam Stuff is getting to the point where enough people are buying stuff and the email list is getting big enough that all of a sudden that product is going to become a platform for who knows what else next. So I guess that's what I mean as far as the benefit of having your finger in a bunch of different pies. And I agree, you shouldn't have 5 of them to start, but you should have one until you could get that product to the level of it being a platform that you could roll into something else.
Yeah, I'm a believer that, you know, I'm a guy that's always tried to do like a million things at once at my own detriment. And the things that I focused on the longest or the most intensely on were the ones that brought me the most success. Now, I spent, you know, a decade working on getting on TV and being able to sort of, you know, have the ability to sort of, you know, do that. And, you know, finally I got there and I didn't get the thing that I set out for, but then that opened up the door for a project I'll talk about at some other point, you know, for that. And that worked out great. It was exactly what I wanted and got to the position like, oh, great, the thing I wanted to do 10 years ago, which then 5 years ago didn't look like nobody could do it. Now looks like it could happen. And I think that, you know, that was a thing for me. Having every morning I woke up, I said, this is the one thing that I will work for. There will be other projects today. There will be other things I do. But today, every day, the primary project is this. When I got into writing, it was 4 years ago now, I realized that I got super intent into writing that first year when I said, man, there's this awesome outlet that doesn't have to rely on anybody else. I wrote six books my first year. I wrote six books that first year. And one book, you know, been in continuous, you know, was in continuous development for film from everybody was involved in it, from the Transformer producers to Blumhouse, you know, who do Paranormal Activity. And now officially got announced Friday, the producers of Still Alice, the Julianne Moore film, his name is James Brown. He's a great producer, very, very sharp guy. He has optioned the rights for Public Enemy Zero to be made into a film.
Yeah.
Congratulations. So we'll see. That's awesome.
You know, I have
that's an option, but still, it's good. Well, and that's the thing is again, I used to always worry about, you know, whenever there was some kind of deal, if you were allowed to talk about it, oftentimes I'd keep my mouth shut because I didn't want to jinx it or whatever. But then I realized more than often than not, these options, you know, just expire and that's as far as they go. And so to me, it's like the joy of having gotten that far in the tournament is its own reward. And so I'll tell everyone about that stuff as soon as I'm able.
Yeah. You know, and for this too, like, and part of what happens too is you keep going along with things, you get other people supportive. And so that deal happened because of Marcel Sarmiento, who's a really good director, a great director who loved the book, you know, and then followed with it a couple years ago when it went through different option stuff and then said, you know, if I bring this here, get this person here, you know, I want to be involved with it. And so that happened. That's one of the things that happens too is you develop people who are, find people who are very passionate about what happens, you know, happens with it. And so, he's a person that, you know, Marcel, I owe, you know, a debt of gratitude for, you know, the state that's, and we'll see, you know, hopefully this thing happens, you know, right now the producers are at, you know, Toronto International Film Festival, saying, hey, you know, want to fund a movie and, you know, see what we can do. And there's a long road to it, but it came from, that all came from just intensity and saying, you know, I'm going to lock myself in my room and I'm going to write and I'm going to figure out a path to make things better as quickly as I can. And, I talked about this Justin the other day, Justin Robert Young. I don't know if you guys know him. He'd be great on here some point.
Yeah, you should get him on.
I don't know. He's kind of a wild animal.
Maybe sometime if I can't make it, you can bring him on.
Well, we hope that won't happen. But
yeah, me too.
So Justin and I were talking about the fact that I came across this quote, and my life has changed radically in the last 3 weeks. I've had a significant, hugely impactful thing, positive, wonderful, wonderful, wonderful thing that's changed. And it started from about 3 weeks ago. You know, I keep waking up in the middle of the night, very anxious about my future, very anxious about what I'm trying to do and going like, man, do I know what I'm doing or whatever? And you know, you stay up late at night staring at the ceiling, trying to entertain yourself. And then finally you fall asleep and then you get up the next day and you don't kind of care with that much intensity that you did before. This time I woke up, it was a Monday, woke up 7:30 in the morning. And remembered, like, yeah, I was really stressed out last night, and I'm not writing as much as I should be. I'm not writing nearly as much as I should be doing, and I need to get back into that groove, because my problem was I would get up after surfing the web for a while, go get lunch, come back from lunch, hang out leisurely, and then finally start to write in the evening. And I was lucky that I can write really fast, and so if I got behind, I could catch up, but that really wasn't a good pattern. So I made a decision 3 weeks ago when I woke up one Monday morning. It's like, go get caffeine, go get a donut or whatever so you have the energy, sit down at your keyboard and write before you go to lunch. Mm-hmm. I sat down, I wrote before I went to lunch. Came back, wrote again. Kept doing it day after day after day. In 2 weeks' time, I finished a novel I was working on. You know, and I've written novels in shorter times, but this was a consistent, let me try to work at it. And I'd gotten a problem where I had one novel take me 3 months, which was horrifying for me. But this thing, I finished it in 3 weeks, and then I went to In-N-Out Burger to say, that was a great job. You know what, though? Like, what was my average? I only did 4,000 words a day. That's good. But, you know, one day I did 10,000. I said, you know, a long time ago, I wrote 17,000 words in one day. and I normally, my pattern is I would finish a book, and then I'd pat myself on the back and not do anything for a while because, like, hey, I finished a book. I said, you know what? I had a lot of fun this time. I had a lot of fun writing this time. When I get back for lunch, what if I just try to write something else? And I had an idea that I said, oh, I'll go do that. I'm like, no, let's do this now. So I had an idea for a story that would make a perfect novella. Got back from lunch, sketched out what I needed to do, 24 hours later, I had written 20,000 words.
Holy cow! Finished this novella. Okay. That's amazing.
And I love the premise. I won't share with you yet, but I'm going to try to get this done and get this out there soon. I have a friend who's a director. I said, listen, we need to go shop this thing around because it'd be really cool. But it was just this momentum. And then after that, I jumped right into another. I said, let me do, and I had to go to, you know, something in Atlanta. But I had an idea there, and I came back, and I jumped right into, like, I have another idea for a novella, which will probably be novel length by Monday. And so the thing that changed for me was, is I said, the moment I get up, I'm about being a writer. I can have a few minutes of surfing the web before I get out of bed, but once I get out of bed, I'm a writer today. And I can go write, go to lunch, and after that, you know, I can do whatever I want, but I'll want to get back into it if I'm that excited. And this sort of was funny because at the same time I tried this habit, I've been reading the book Power of Habit on your recommendation, Brian, I was also listening to an audiobook when I went for a walk at night, and I love these old-timey sort of self-help stuff.
Oh, yeah.
And I was going back to The Richest Man in Babylon, which was by George Samuel Klassen wrote this book, which is actually a collection of pamphlets. And I'm walking along, and this thing, I listen to this thing in my head. I go, oh, that's so good. I have to replay it. And I've told it to my other friends, and they've all gone, oh, yeah. And I'll read this passage to you. And basically, the premise of the book is these people in ancient Babylon. It's not a true story, by the way. But
it's a series of parables, right?
Exactly. Sure. They go to this man who's supposed to be the richest man in Babylon to ask him how he became so wealthy. And he tells them the habits and the things that he did.
And by the way, keep in mind, the two main characters, one's a chariot maker, and he's the best chariot maker in the land. The other's a minstrel. He's the best minstrel in the land. And their old elementary school friend, who was not as smart as they were, not as talented as they were, and yet somehow is the richest man in Babylon.
Did not realize they had elementary schools in Babylon.
When they were children.
So... Arkad is the name, and he talks to me. He says, willpower, retorted Arkad. What nonsense. Do you think willpower gives a man the strength to lift a burden the camel cannot carry, or to draw a load the oxen cannot budge? Willpower is but the unflinching purpose to carry a task you set yourself to fulfillment. If I set for myself a task, be it ever so trifling, I shall see it through. How else shall I have confidence in myself to do important things? Should I say to myself, for 100 days, as I walk across the bridge into the city, I will pick from the road a pebble and cast it into the stream, I would do it. If on the 7th day I passed by without remembering, I would not say to myself, tomorrow I will cast 2 pebbles, which will do as well. Instead, I would retrace my steps and cast the pebble. And it goes on to say that I wouldn't then decide on the 20th day it was useless or whatever. But
and that's the thing is, like he says, you know, I wouldn't get impatient and reach over and grab a fistful of pebbles and just throw a whole bunch over.
Most important thing is, like, how many, like, I look at how many times, like, I miss, like, oh, I'll go write. I didn't write it today, but, you know, tomorrow I'll write double. Tomorrow I'll do this.
Or the reverse, where you're like, well, yesterday I did 20,000 words, so today I could take it easy. I got way ahead of schedule yesterday. I don't know if I've shared this on the program, but this is quite possibly the single most important book that shaped my entire career. You know, the idea that a part of everything you earn is yours to keep is, as a matter of fact, CJ, I talked him into it. You know, I gave it to CJ, and CJ, it deeply affected him. And CJ, at one of his lectures, ended up buying an entire pallet of this book, and for 2 years just gave it to everyone he met and remotely cared about, hoping that it would fall on at least some good ears. And in fact, we usually, if we ever give a cash gift to, like, a graduate from high school, we'll usually include a copy of it as well. But The Richest Man in Babylon, because it is written in a timeless age, its lessons are utterly timeless as well.
There's a version on Audible. There's many versions of it because it's fallen into the public domain. That the narrator is Grover Gardner is the narrator of the version I've listened to. And you can buy it on right now for $2 on Amazon.
What?
You can own it outright. $2. $2 for the Audible version of it.
All right. Richest.
$1.95.
Man, so not even $2.
Yeah. And I'll play you his voice here. And
here we go.
Chapter 12.
Oh, wrong book.
Here, I got it.
I got it.
Yeah. So Babylonian ancient. To see whether they knew how to attract good luck. The sun had just set like a great red ball of fire shining through the haze of desert dust when Arkad like strolled to his accustomed platform.
Anyhow, that's the guy's voice. He's got that old-timey lot of pell-mells, whatever, but
Yeah, man. Hang on. I got to sign in to Amazon here so I could buy that. I'm not going to use the credit for it because it's so cheap. Richest.
Oh, yeah. Don't waste credit on
$2. $1.95. Just buy it.
Yeah. It's one of those books that I'll reread every 3 or 4 years, and each time you get a new lesson. My favorite is, I don't know if you've gotten there yet, but he eventually tells the story of a man whose, you know, debts were so great that he got sold into slavery. I mean, you know, talk about, you know, utterly despondent, had nothing there, and showed how by providing value and that by remembering that a part of everything you earn is yours to keep, he's able to go from slavery to a position of wealth that he could buy off his own debt. And then he goes about paying off all his debtors, even though he doesn't have to, and eventually becomes wealthy himself. And when you hear it expressed in the simplest of terms, in terms of gold pieces for hard labor, that's the brilliance of it, is that it's a blank canvas for you to project your own labors, whether they be creative or working for a large corporation.
No, that's a very valuable lesson. I read it years ago as a paperback, and this is my first time as an audiobook, so I don't remember. I'll have to get to that. And that's that thing you point out there, the idea of paying back debtors when you don't have to, is a very... And part of the reason you do that is the idea that you might say, well, you know, I don't have to because of bankruptcy or this because whatever. Well, the next time you want to start something, if you paid people back, they're the first ones you go to, and they'll help you. If you don't pay them back, you have to find an entirely new group of people to pursue.
And also, there's something in you. Like that's baggage you're going to carry, knowing that you owe that money. And you may be the kind of, you know, sociopath that could just write that off, but... Meanwhile,
well, it's okay, since there are people like there's just extenuating circumstances where they're never going to be able to.
Sure, and that's fine. And there are genuinely places where it's like, yeah, I don't have the money. I'm never going to have the money. You plan to make money because you thought I was a good bet. Turns out I'm a bad bet, and this is the end of it. You know, how much? You know, you could buy back your debt for pennies on the dollar or whatever. But I don't know if I talked about it on the air, but Marco Tempest has an amazing story of how he was flying high in the early 90s with the production, but had a scammy manager who left him holding an insurmountable amount of debt and just bailed on him. And he had to start over from scratch. And he spent several years doing all these corporate gigs and just because he couldn't handle the idea that people knew him as a deadbeat or had his company associated with being a deadbeat. And he went back and paid back hundreds of thousands of dollars to all of these debtors that, you know, because he just didn't know. He was off busy doing the magic show and didn't know he was getting screwed on the management side.
That takes a lot of character to say, you know, let me go in there and, you know, get rid of this or take care of this. But that's the understanding of, you know what, like, I don't want to live with that.
And one great thing, and again, I think I'm going to be on. This is my pick for sure for this conversation. Whether you are young, fresh out of college, trying to figure out how to shape your future, whether you are deeply in debt, trying to figure out how to get back on top, whether you're late in life and wondering if it's too late to get yourself to a place of financial security, there are parables and lessons in each of these, and because they are written in that timeless manner, there are true truths, as a certain animal fairy would say, that you'll be able to take away from this.
I'm gonna say, like, let's have that as our pick, you know, our joint pick, if we're all cool with that.
Yeah.
And I'll leave with a story here, and I think you guys are probably may have covered this, you know, an amazing success story is, of course, Notch, Marcus Notch Person, you know, who wrote, I mean, created, you know, took somebody else's base idea, you know, with permission, and made a billion-dollar franchise out of Minecraft. And this guy sold it, billionaire, became a billionaire, bought, you know, was able to buy one of the most expensive homes in all of, you know, LA, out from under all the pop stars and everybody else who was trying to get it out, because guess what? His video game money was a lot greener than their money, you know? And he had a little bit of a, I don't know, event took place on Twitter where he was talking about the problem. He put a thing on Twitter that said, the problem with getting everything is you run out of reasons to keep trying, and human interaction becomes impossible due to imbalance. And, you know, he was basically a little bit melancholy over the fact that, you know, he's stupidly wealthy right now. and it's made problems difficult, like, you know, relationships, you know, it's just that it's everybody around him is different. The girls who maybe attract him are different, and he feels very, very isolated and alone.
That's true, because and not so much that I would know from the money perspective, but I certainly, I don't know. And you're probably in the same place, Andrew. I would say, would it be fair to say that you and me are in a different place from a celebrity perspective than we were 5 years ago?
Oh yeah, absolutely. And, I mean, it's a there's this. You know, we have a basic cable credibility kind of thing there that comes through there. And there's people bet money on us and said, we'll do this. We'll put by people gone. You know, had multiple people go in and say, OK, we'll put you out there and go do this, which carries undue weight, carries an inappropriate amount of weight in an environment where,
right,
you know, if you have a sex tape and a very rich father, you can have a TV show.
Well, and that's what I'm getting
Tom,
at.
Oh, for two.
Yeah.
Well. Here it's a double-edged sword, and I understand that sense of isolation, because on the one hand, it is pretty cool, those moments that people say, oh, I know you from that thing, skip the line, come on in, or have this before someone else, or whatever those little things are. It's delightful. You know, it's great that we could get on camera and say, I think it'd be cool if I made a card game about presidential debates, and then you know, because you're known, you can make that stuff happen. However, it is crushingly isolating when you realize that you can't be out in public and pick your nose and not have the suspicion that somebody's, you know, recording it, you know, and it's like you find yourself on best behavior at all times. And again, that's the trade-off, but I could understand how. Like, let me put it this way. I am glad I am not dating, because if I was dating everyone I talked to, I would constantly be thinking, like, why is she here? Is she here for this? Is she here for that? Is she the kind of person who's going to talk about what we do and blah, 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 blah?
Yeah. The advantage of living in a place in LA is, you know, yeah, far more famous and wealthier people out there. So if a girl's dating me, I kind of know why, you know.
Whatever notoriety I have, I enjoy very much the fact that when someone comes up and recognizes me, it's because they like something I did, and that's it. And
I've been there. I've been there for both of you guys, you know, in very random, not just geeky, nerdy places where your fans go up to your nerdy male fans go up to you to tell you how much they love what you do. And it's very sincere, though. They're not going up to you because you're some guy they saw on TV. They're going up to you because they listen and they connect with your art or what you do.
Right.
Yeah, like the guy I saw in the grocery store who was like, hey, I love Corn Killers, you know? And he went off to finish his grocery shopping and I went off to finish mine. There was nothing weird about it.
That's perfect.
It's perfect. To me, that's perfect.
Yeah, that's I realized, like, for me, like, I was at a party and it was family and all their friends had seen the show. And it was a weird, unpleasant experience.
It was your family?
Yeah, and friends of my family.
Yeah, no, I just did a family reunion, and it's a weird, eclectic mix, because you have some set of the family that saw you poop your pants, and then there's other subsets of the family.
Well, no, it was their friends that made it weird. I mean, they're nice people, but it's just like, oh, do this. And like, it's like, man, I just kind of want to sit here and eat cake.
Monkey. Yeah.
Yeah. And I was very uncomfortable, because it was, then it's like, oh, they want to talk about, you know, the conversation stem around things that you've had that same conversation 500 times, yeah, you know, and,
well, you know, you find yourself dipping into familiar material and it feels artificial and weird.
Yeah. And I know that, like, I've always looked at it like a means to an end. Like, I'm not a person that ever wanted to, like, I mean, maybe when I was younger and I didn't know any better, that wanted, you know, people just to go up to me on the street and be like, hey, you're so and so, whatever. I just like to do cool things. That's what I want to be able to do, is do cool things. And so, you know, and that's having a little bit of, you know, doing a little tiny little show and being able to have that experience. Like, great. This just gels for me, what I know, what I want, and what I don't want. It's about the work, and that's what we were talking about before. I know what the work I want to do. Yeah. If I'm on camera, it's because I'm going to be promoting. I want to do it because I'm promoting science or something, not because I just want to put my stupid face on TV.
Well, and that's the thing, is like, there is a certain, it's that, you know, product becoming platform thing. It's like, you know, you, the product was, you did the TV show, and now that becomes a platform. you know, for, to help bolster your ability to sell books. And
your face becomes a platform for science.
Yes. You balance science on your face.
It opened, like, I have a project which I'll maybe be able to talk a little bit more in a couple months that's, you know, a great, fun science thing that I've wanted to do with a high profile and everything. And that happened because I did the other thing. Yep. The other thing happened because of that, you know.
Yeah, man.
The key is to go do things. No matter what level of success you have, and that's when we're talking about specialization versus not specialization, like, just do stuff that you like to do, because doing things will more often lead to other things than not doing things.
Brian set foot out in front of his doorstep. You know, Tom pursued journalism, and then Tom turned on those microphones and kept doing that, you know, every day, doing shows, even if nobody wanted to see you, nobody wanted to hear you, nobody cared.
That's how you know.
Tom still did it.
Well, it started with me doing subbrilliant.com. Which started from me doing an e-zine because I wanted to do it. Like, those are both basically unknown things from the 90s that I did because I just wanted to do them, and they led to other things.
Yeah. An e-zine.
Yeah, right?
Gentlemen,
it was a
thank you very much.
Yeah, man. It's been after.
Things.
Saving copy as... We did it again, boys. We fooled them all.
Ah, just like usual.
Never mess with this formula, ever.
Right? Never change.
Let's see. Weird things. What do we... I guess I'll call it...
So I just want... I did not talk about the iPad Pro at all.
Oh, are you... you know what's funny is I did not watch the announcement, and I guess I need to for the Apple TV stuff, Tom. Because what little I saw of it sounded like Apple TV was getting closer to my imagined artificially intelligent concierge.
Their promise is what you've been wanting.
Yeah,
the devil's in the details how well it works.
Right,
that's all.
So I need to watch that. But I didn't see any of the iPhone or iPad stuff, so I am temporarily shielded from the wantsies. Like, at this moment, I'm perfectly happy with this, but I know the moment I watch the rest or read the articles, I'll get a little amped up.
I did the pre-order. But this was the first time I hesitated, and I still may not go get it. I'm still you know, on the fence on it, because it's hardware looks fantastic, but I love my 6 Plus. I love the size of it.
So if you're going to go to a 6 Plus S, what are we looking at that we're getting that's new?
3D touch.
Camera. What's that, Tom?
3D touch.
Okay, the 3D touch does not sound compelling to me. I don't really follow the. I don't grab
rose
that.
Gold.
Rose gold.
Oh, way even better camera. 4K video recording.
4K video recording.
Know.
Yeah,
that's legit.
Much faster chip. You know, so games and everything else.
Yeah, faster Hearthstone loading.
Yeah, the answer is that it's the same kind of thing with every phone. Is it if it had a different case, we'd be easy to go, oh well, look, it looks like this case is now it's a different shape. I'm with you in the sense that I'm kind of like, well, you know, I don't need it, but I'm gonna want it.
Yeah
My problem with the S features is they're never like Siri, Touch ID, 3D touch, they're never enough to make me go, have I been missing that? And once I get them, because I always skip a generation, once I get them, then I'm like, oh, yeah, okay, that's kind of neat. But I never regret that I skipped it.
That's interesting.
If I do skip, this will be the first generation I've ever skipped. And I even said I was going to skip last generation, but couldn't help myself.
Oh, but yeah,
I've
last time, just the screen
every generation, every
like,
S generation.
I'm still, you know, I pick mine up in 12 days, but I'm going to decide if I may skip it and just go do the iPad Pro.
Now that I actually think would be a pretty awesome idea. It's pretty good. What's that?
I wanted them to update. I think the iPad Pro is great. I wanted another 10-inch tablet. I've been waiting to replace my third generation iPad, and I don't know if I need 12.9 inches.
Yeah.
I mean, I put it here, and I put it on a prompter. And in both places, 10 inches is perfect size.
That's the standard shape of the iPad?
Yeah, the 9-inch and whatever. 8. Yeah.
9.7.
We can add the specs right now.
The thing with the Pro that got me excited was landscape, you know, full size keyboard on, because I do a bit of typing on there. There's been a lot of things that I've always sort of wanted to do with, you know, in the iOS world with a pen or a stylus, and I bought like these other, you know, the other sort of styli for it, but they've just not quite been there. And the reaction that people have where they're comparing this as, you know, Microsoft, by the way, changed, you know, the new version of the Surface, you know, they it's less sophisticated of a stylus they had before because to right. try to cut costs back on it. But with this, people say this is, as, you know, I've heard people say this is as good as any professional high-end tablet, you know, like drawing thing, use a Pixar, whatever they've done. Obviously, it doesn't have the software, you know, support that those things have. But for somebody like me, you know, who just wants to draw robots.
Dude, what an amazing time to be alive.
Yeah. I think
we'll get 10 more years of this until the rocks rain down on us.
Yeah.
By the way, Tom, the third act of Seven Eves, I the whole time was just wishing that Seven Eves was just the first part of a trilogy and that we would get two more books in the world of the third act.
Cradle just landed. So yeah, I know what you mean.
Like, yeah, I can watch. Wait, Cradle just landed. So you're still in the second act.
Am I? I'm 80% through.
Are you?
I'm in South America.
Is it current time?
You got any gum?
Is it current time?
No, for a future time.
Oh, okay, great. Okay, so yeah, you're into the far future. Great.
Any of you guys read the Star Wars Aftermath?
No.
No, but that's my next up after I finish Seven Eves. It's preloaded already.
Curious to hear your reaction. I've not read it.
What's the story of Aftermath?
It's what happened after the destruction of the second Death Star.
Oh, interesting.
And how, like, elements of the surviving Empire try to clamp down and the Rebellion tries to, you know, consolidate their victories. Basically, like, think about it this way. In the end of Return of the Jedi, the revised edition, you see fireworks going off over Coruscant. Imagine that those fireworks were probably not authorized and the government still hasn't fallen, and what they're going to do as people are tearing down statues and shooting out fireworks.
Got it. Just because they blew up a Death Star doesn't mean... Yeah. They blew up a military installation and assassinated the head in chief.
Yeah, the reviews are quite mixed on it.
Interesting. Right on. Okay, I will catch you guys later.
All right. Yeah, text me when you land.
Will do. Yeah, 9:50 is when it's supposed to happen, and I got to pack up some stuff. I think I'm good. All right.
Thanks, y'all.
Dude, I will let you gentlemen go. I got to run and pack some stuff, so we'll catch you in a bit.
Peace out.
Bye, guys.
Are you gone?
Not yet. Hold on. I'm shutting down streams.